Hi, I'm going to talk on a topic which concerns every one of us, not only us, even the living species. The name of the topic I'm going to talk is plastic rice. Plastic rice. Have you ever heard a word like that? You know rice, you know so many things made up of plastics. Have you ever heard a word, plastic rice? I'm going to talk about it. Very soon we'll have plastic rice. Let me read that before a quote. In 2050, good news, currency notes will be found littered everywhere, including the trash bins. Bad news, food grains can be found only in the currency chest. I think you got the answer. Let me share one more quote before we go to the next. We waste natural resources by using them up, waste human resources by not using it. So if you use more human resources, you can save a lot of natural resources. Let me go to the top, one of the top. Only after the last tree has been cut down, only after the last river has been poisoned, only after the last fish has been caught, only then you will find that money cannot be eaten. It was told by American Native Indians. Okay, Luther Burbank, botanist, says, nature's law affirm instead of prohibiting. If you violate our laws, you are your own prosecuting attorney, judge, jury, and hangman. Let me go to my main presentation. Okay. Food, the rude truths, which I'm going to share with you. Be with me, because it concerns every one of us. Huge food shortage. Expected permanent and continuous food shortage. Steep increase in demand for food and shortfall in supply of food. This is all going to happen in a matter of about 15 years. Threats to farmlands due to nature's anger. Let us see who all pose threat to farming activity and farmlands. Nature became against humans as humans went against nature. You see here, see big catastrophes. The first problem, food front, is called atmosphere warming. We can't control, like a switch on or switch off AC. That consequence of global warming, drastic increase in atmospheric temperature, speeding up of melting of ice caps, glaciers, and ice mountains, which in turn will lead to increase in sea level, which will eventually result in coastal areas going beneath water. Farmlands will get inundated or will become saline. So I think I'm very clear. The sea level will increase and the farmlands will go beneath. You see, the most beautiful animal, polar bear, is now running, fighting for its life because it cannot live without ice, crumbling ice shells. If the West Antarctica sheet were to melt and collapse into the sea, it would push the sea levels up to 10 meters, more than 32 feet, and many coastal areas would completely sink beneath the ocean. So the danger is global warming and global warning, you can call it. Green Iceland melt, 1990 to 2002. In 10 years, what happened? Greenland ice sheet, you can see it here. Atmosphere warming, inundation of loss of farmland due to increase in sea level. Unfortunately, India has got 7,500 km long, low coastline, very low coastline. And you can see the figure, some one or two little mistakes other, but by and large is good. Gujarat has 1,600 long kilometer long coastline, Maharashtra 840, Goa 300, Karnataka 400, West Bengal 950, Tamil Nadu 720, Orissa 560, Kerala 1014, Andhra Pradesh 960. So in result, what will happen? These places, the farmers will be at the worst receiving end. They lose the farmland due to increase of sea level. And the land, even when the water recedes, will become saline, will not be fit for consumption. The second component of climate change is soil warming. The soil is becoming warmer. The same land which you are having now, the yield will be less due to soil warming. And a particular heat is needed, but the heat will be more than that for cultivation. The mind-boggling paradox. Global warming causes excess soil warming and affects agriculture. Agriculture is a large-scale cause for global warming. Climate change and agriculture are interrelated processes, both of which take place on a global scale. Global warming is projected to have significant impacts on conditions affecting agriculture, including temperature, carbon dioxide, glacial runoff, precipitation, and the interaction of these elements. These can determine the carrying capacity of the biosphere to produce enough food for the human population and the domesticated animals. The mind-boggling paradox continued. At the same time, agriculture has been shown to produce significant effects on climate change, primarily through the production and release of greenhouse gases such as carbon dioxide, methane, and nitrous oxide, but also by altering the Earth's land cover, which can change its ability to absorb or reflect heat and light, thus contribute to radioactive forces. Land use and change, such as deforestation and desertification together, which is use of fossil fuels as a major anthropogenic sources of carbon dioxide. Agriculture itself is a major contributor to increasing methane and nitrous oxide concentration in its atmosphere. So sea warming. So I told you about atmosphere warming, and soil warming will affect very badly agriculture. The production will be less. Third is sea warming. And unfortunately or fortunately, 90% people of the world population eat fish. Fish will be very costly. Warming oceans are pushing fish towards the poles instead of cooler waters. According to study, with the rise of the new concerns that climate change is robbing the tropics of the primary source of income and nutrition. So lots of food, sea warming make wind warmer. So the three warming, particularly sea warming, atmosphere warming, soil warming, and sea warming. And sea warming makes wind warmer. When the wind becomes warmer, this is about warming oceans, and it's reshaping the fisheries. They say some of the fish species size is getting reduced due to climate change. That's what they say. Sea warming, a lot of particulars. It's not just a case of dwindling fish population and migration of fish population towards south near Antarctic. It's much more than that. Global warming is likely to shrink the size of fish as much as a quarter in coming decades, according to a groundbreaking new study of the world's oceans. In other words, the fish will drastically shrink in its size. Reduction in individual fish size will be matched by a dwindling of overall fish stocks, warned scientists at a time when the world's growing human population is putting ever greater pressure on fisheries. So one side, the population increasing, we need more fishes, but fish number is dwindling and the fish production is dwindling at the same time. Fish size also is shrinking. Scientists fear declining Arctic sea ice and warming waters may have caused an unprecedented mass migration of thousands of walrus from the ice floes to dry land along Alaska's coast. Wind warming. Atmospheric soil warming, sea warming lead to wind warming. Wind warming will make cyclones, hurricanes, typhoons more violent, virulent, volatile, and frequent. Wind will cause destruction of agriculture, forests, including uprooting of fruit-bearing trees. So all of you know it happened in Kadalur, Thane. A few hour cyclone uprooted jackfruit trees and killed all cashew crops. And same thing happened in the Katrina in America. It's like you are eating an energy drink. The wind becomes warmer. When it becomes warmer, it gets energized. It becomes very volatile. Global warming causes wind warming, which causes storms. The above picture show a model how a cyclone is generated by the temperature difference and the wind flow caused by the warmth of the ocean. Typhoons play a significant role in disturbing the ocean's heat. Oceans, which cover 2/3 of planet's surface and absorbs massive amounts of heat from the atmosphere. Cyclones whip up the sea like a spinning steel blades of a food mixie. Cyclone. Scientists have long studied the relationship between warmer sea surface temperatures and cyclonic, slowly spinning storms into the Atlantic Ocean. But new study attempts to project how many of the most damaging hurricanes could result from warming air temperatures as well. The number of Atlantic storms with magnitude similar to killer Hurricane Katrina, which devastated the US Gulf Coast in 2005, could rise sharply this century. Environment research reported recently, a writer reported, you can see wind warming causing damages of crop and killing all the trees, fruit bearing trees. So we, 2020, will witness serious food shortage and we'll see food and water civil war. Soil warming will cause less farm output, sea warming will kill fishes, result in lesser fish production. Soil warming, I told you about it, and then sea warming. All of those things, what is soil degradation? Apart from that, why we'll get less food? The soil is being continuously subjected to abuse and degradation. Soil degradation in soil deteriorates because of human activity and loses its quality and productivity. Happens when soil loses nutrients and its organic matter. It also happens when the soil structure breaks down, becomes toxic from pollution. The primary cause of soil degradation is erosion, but compaction, salinization, and the depletion of nutrient demanding crops may also cause degradation. Soil degradation, which is the movement of soil particles from one place to another by wind or water, is considered to be a major environmental problem. Erosion has been going on through most of the Earth's history and has produced river valleys and shaped hills and mountains. Such erosion is generally slow, but the action of man has caused a rapid increase in the rate at which soil is eroded. That is, the rate faster than natural weathering of bedrock can produce new soil. This resulted in loss of productive soil from crop and grazing land, as a layers of infertile soils being deposited on formerly fertile crop lands. The formation of gullies, siltation of lakes and streams, and landscapes. Man has a capacity for major destruction of landscapes and soil resources. Hopefully, he has also ability to prevent and overcome these problems. So we go to the next picture. So what, the soil degradation, we explained it, and you can see this picture will be shown for a few minutes, this picture. Okay. Farmland cancer due to use of chemical pesticide. So chemical pesticide is, US does use aircraft. The land has been chemicalized. You know, we talk about naturopathy and all. Allopathy, you are injecting chemicals to your body. Same thing happened to land, and unfortunately, when the land is excessively chemicalized, the chemicals come to your body when you eat that food, chemically grown food. So that's why you get cancer and so many other diseases. And this is genetically modified. You don't need, ultimately we need to depend on some farmers, seed producers in America, because our crop will not yield any more, what you call, seeds. So next is the peak oil. Unfortunately, even many politicians do not know about it. What is peak oil? If you ask me, I'll tell you that the oil production will touch the highest ever in a few years. When the oil touches ever, then there will be a drop in production. Even there's a little less drop, marginal drop in oil production, there will be psychological pressure. The oil price will shoot up. Probably 1 liter will be sold 3,000 rupees. You know why? Peak oil. What is peak oil? People understand the oil is not going to get continuously. Once the oil production, the oil wells start get drying up, and the oil price will go up, and the production will come down. The moment it comes down, there will be peak oil. Peak oil means oil production will touch the highest, and naturally the price will go up. But the catch is not peak oil, peak food. Because even now, 80% of food is grown by chemical fertilizers. So the chemical fertilizers you won't get, because most of the chemical fertilizers you get from petroleum chemicals. So petrol will be costly, naturally fertilizer will be oil. The peak oil, we have a separate presentation, which I am not going into it. We show separately what is peak oil. Peak oil will lead to peak food will lead to peak poverty. Peak poverty lead to peak anarchy. That means anarchy will be the highest. Okay, all this is going to happen. So, one more issue. More than that, you'll have less food, more stomachs. How do you explain for it? So, India, somebody said very proudly, we are going to overtake China in population. Do you think we should feel pride about it? No, we should not feel about it. We are going to surpass. So, whether we do anything else or not, we keep producing children. So, the population is going to increase. So, this is a population growth slips. But India, India is stopping. This picture will be shown for a few moments. You will see that. And I'm not going into statistics. I'm going into some very bare root truths. Urbanization. What is urbanization? Urbanization is physical growth of urban areas as a result of rural migration, even suburban concentration to cities, particularly very large ones. When India got the independence, the urban area was less than 34%. By 2050, it's predicted that 64%, 0.1%, 85.9% of the developed world respectively be urbanized. That means villages will disappear, villages will become towns. Where will you get rice? Villages are giving you rice. Where will you get it? Urbanization will lead to loss of huge chunk of farmlands and villages losing the charm and natural beauty. So the villages, the film directors go and take shooting. Villages won't look same villages. And farmland becoming building land. What do you say for that? Building land. What for all? You're going to see that. See, look at this land. The same picture taken from a hill. All the farmlands are gone. Somebody asked him, where do you live? He said, he lives west to Annanagar, west extension. I said, come and repeat it. Annanagar came, then another west came. Then west Annanagar came, and now west to, west to another west extension means, I don't know where it will be. Somebody said today, Tirumalisi will be a new Annanagar. And I think one day what will happen? Annanagar will grow up to Bangalore, Bangalore will grow up to Chennai. In the bargain, you lose all the farmlands. You just go, look everywhere, both sides. Better shut your eyes. Farmlands are being butchered. The hen laying golden necks are being killed. So understand, construction of building on farmlands. We have nearly 40,000 photos on these pictures. Concrete jungles everywhere. And murder of farmlands due to accelerated urbanization. We have land cancer. Farmlands becoming housing and industry land. Instead of crops, buildings grow. The agricultural production will drop down by 20% by 2020 due to shrinking farmlands. So you must understand, So, yeah, advertisement came in Hindu. I'm publishing it here. New layout with a tall building proudly says what life can be. But I want to ask them, what is life going to be? Because they occupied the paddy producing land and constructed building. And murder of farmlands begins with the layouts, land for sale, and everywhere. And I am going to tell you how all this land is being subjected to abuse. Murder of farmlands for laying layouts continued. And farmlands, thousands of schools and colleges have been considered farmlands last 2 years. We got through RTA. So the colleges teach about farming, agriculture college sitting on the farmland. And the college teaches irrigation sitting on a tank, lake. What do you say about it? Who gave them permission to do that? And that's a point. 1,200 college schools on farmland started. And industries. I don't want to name it. Some automobile industries come here, they play a trick with the government. They say, give us 1,000 acres land, 500 acres land. And when the CM considers, says, I'll consider, they say, if you don't have, don't really go to Karnataka. That's a competition in Karnataka and Tamil Nadu. They exploit it. You can see here, Sipcot Estate on farmlands. The industries who come from abroad, they take 1,000 acres. You know why? They need only 100 acres. In case of the factory fails, they'll sell their land into building land. And the moment they take over, at least what they should do, suppose they take 1,000 acres, 100 acres, they have an automobile industry, balance 900 acres, they should do cultivation. They grow Korean grass. Can you eat Korean grass? Come on, tell me. Who is to control? Who is going to talk to that? That's why today, through you, we are starting. All of you watching, Kisan Bhagwan, if you're a farmer, I'm prepared to touch your feet. You are our God. Our great Valluvar said, Urudundu Vaalvare Vaalvar, Matra Vallan Thurudundu Pilsuvar. Only the farmer lives, others go worshipping with the folded hands. That's what he said. Uluvukum Thoilukum Vandani Seivom. That's what Bhardiyar said. We'll worship the farmers and the workers. What happens? Everywhere, this all Thiruvai Kandigai. Another Nandigram happening near Chennai, forest life, even tire industry is coming. They are taking all the farmlands. Farmers know only farming. They don't have become BA, BL, MBA and all. They know only farming. And they know only farming, you're going to take them out, they'll refugee. They become refugees their own homeland. I went to Dindukal, there's a village which produces the best brinjal in the world. Do you know they buy brinjal from outside? Because Chinese have come on the farmlands. Who is going to protect the farmland? Who is going to protect the farmers? You think by protecting farmers, you are protecting somebody else. You are wrong. You are protecting yourself. Unless farmer produces food, you will have no food. I'll tell you one simple thing for all of you to understand. All of us take, I'm not taking, most of us take liquor. We can remain with taking liquor. The liquor manufacturers have become billionaires. They become filthily rich. We smoke. People smoke. They can remain without smoking. The people produce cigarettes are billionaires. We eat. We can't remote without eating. But the people who produce food, the farmers, commit suicide. They buy pesticide to kill the pest, but they take the pesticide to kill themselves. What is going to happen? It's a wake-up call I'm giving to Indians. And if you are not producing farmlands, you are doing a great injustice to children. There'll be only blood flowing everywhere. And here you see, this another hero residence. They don't know what to do. They do everything. But the foreign multinationals, they have financial muscle, all muscles, I don't want to explain. They come and take the farmland. And the farmers, they get the money. And because they lost the farmland, they lost all interest in life. They become alcoholics. They die. The children come to streets. We are destroying the greatest, oldest professionals, farmers. Kindly remember that. Farmlands are fast becoming industrial estates. Another danger you are seeing. Murder of farmlands for laying roads. So many roads. The roads are being widened and they cut the trees and they lay the roads. Construction of roads on farmlands. Again, you see here. And 2,000 crores. There's going to be Greenfield Airport. Greenfield Airport. Where? The farmland, Sriperumbudur, is going to come. So everywhere. Construction of railways on farms. And construction of pipelines on farms. Pipelines. You know what happens? It's not only pipeline. There's leakage of oil. And the oil movement, it goes to farmland, the farm becomes unfit. Come and tell me, who is going to protect the farmers? So I am launching today, oil spills into paddy fields from oil pipeline. And Nagapattinam people, I cry. I'm telling you, the day is not far off. Newspapers publish. Tangerines by importers from some other country. It's going to happen. sooner or later. Many differences can be seen when you compare people in different countries. But one thing that's universal is our need to eat and sustain ourselves. Lack of rainfall for crops, soil degradation, desertification, soil salinity are factors that contribute to terrible physical hardships and famines around the world. Without food, we can no longer exist. We see these types of situations through the mass media and our concern. There are so many people with little or nothing to eat. So the next thing is called desertification. I told you how farmlands being butchered and farmlands being real estate. I want to tell you one more thing. I got some NRA friends. That NRA friend, he's got so much money. He's bought one house or a flat in each of the, what you call, the places like Ooty, Kodaikanal, Nainital, everywhere. And he's never going to come. He's going to come once in 2 years. He's going to, will go in one place. All the time it remains locked. There are people on Kuom banks. The sky is the roof, they live. But people own so many houses. I don't think anybody should own a house more than, nobody should be allowed to have a house more than 2,000 square feet. And because the supply is less. Land, do you think land supply is going to get its supply like any other thing? Can you get land supply? Can you buy land from, import land from America or England? Land, once you give for some other use, put into use, you can't get back the land. The land is gone for once and forever. You can't get back farming again. How do you get back? Don't forget, if my mouth is stitched, I can't eat. For water table, the farmlands are the mouth. The water tables gets recharged by through farmland. When the water stays there, the water percolates down, it goes to the water table. You get the water in the well. If you construct building on farmland, what will happen? There won't be, you know, there'll be water shortage. There'll be water shortage. And we have, you know, everywhere the sea water, the moment you keep, you know, drawing more water, there'll sea water intrusion. The groundwater will get polluted. It'll become saline. It's all happening already. Most of the coastal town is having. And they put bore 500 feet, 600 feet. At the rate they'll go and reach South America without a passport or visa. They'll reach it. Deserts are growing due to climate change. Deserts are growing. Global urbanization map showing percentage of urbanization per country. And then food percentage at problem at a glance. I told you all those things. I'm not going to repeat it. I covered all the list. Again, it's all repeated here. If you want this presentation to be crisp, I hope you can pause this picture and see this, read this. I'll conclude this talk with only one appeal to all the farmers. I again bow my ear to farmers. I request all the people who see this picture, after praying your God, over God, keep a photo of a farmer and bow your head. Say a namaste to him. If you want, you can worship or at least say, good morning, farmer. We thank you, farmer. You keep telling that, it will create a very positive vibration. What's happening in the footprint? I want to tell you, apart from all those things, farmers have lost interest. Because due to climate change, the rainfall is not very consistent. And number two, they all depend on rivers. Rivers are flowing before man came. Man's greed, they put dams. It doesn't get water. So naturally, farming, they really is the best option. They sell their land for real estate. I want to tell the farmers, don't sell for real estate. If you only hold the land, one day the land price will make you a Tata or Birla. Each land will sell because land supply is going to reduce. Whoever has land, they'll be richer. You will be richer. Don't hurry up to sell your land. I must tell you here, don't give up your land, your rights to land. You have to protect your land. That's very important. I want to share with you. So the point is, farmers. What are the problems for farmers? Farmers, one is water. First water. But I want to tell you, I've been to many nations. Israel, if you take in particular, one third of water or one half of the water we use, they get two times more food production. How? If that country is doing, why not we do? What we do, we flood the land, but it's all root bed, you know, the water is taken to the roots by Israelis. They say we allow water to evaporate. Anyway, we have to study that. Even too much of water, countries like desert countries don't have water. They know the value of water. So you understand what is going to be the scarce commodity. So farmers' problem is water is first. They need seeds. They need workers. They need rain at the time of plowing the land. They need seedling then. They need to plant it. Then they need to remove the weeds. They have to fertilize. They have to spray pesticides. They have to harvest. When they harvest, there should be no rain. If the rain, the entire crop will get lost. There's no storage facility. And the food, when they harvest, is sold very big price that doesn't sell. There's no market. And come on, you tell me, I was working in the bank. Even if it take leave, I was getting my pay. What about farmers? Where they'll get income? If all these problems are going to that. Here, I want to give one advice and wind up my talk. I belong to trade union movement called AIBA, All India Bank Employees. You know, bank employees today, you are very lucky in the sense, your life is comfortable. I don't say you are very rich, but life is comfortable. Bank gives loan for everything. And bank life is very good. I want to say the credit goes to AIBA, All India Bank Employees. Comrade Prabhatkar founded it. Comrade Parvana, now Comrade Vengadachalam from Tamil Nadu. He's the leader for AIBA. What AIBA, I'll tell you, what the farmers should learn from AIBA. AIBA, they want more salary increase. They go on strike. They go on strike, Kashmir to Kanyakumari, all of them. They don't do work bank. I'm not going into merits of strike, whether right or wrong, but they go on strike. They never say whether Tamil, Telugu, Kannadiga or Hindi, they never say that. When Comrade Sejwana gives a call, everybody on the streets. There's no second rule. Nobody can make them go inside. They are very united. I go to Rotary Club, Lions Club. We have Exnora everywhere. We never say Tamil, Telugu, Malayalam, Kannadam, Hindi. We never say Naidu, Reddiyar, Chettiyar, Mudaliyar. That's all we don't say. But farmers were cleverly divided by the political powers. You must understand. In the name of water. I want to tell you, water, take W, water. Water, A, available, T, two, E, everyone, really. Water, available, two, everyone, really. But it's not want of water management. But what happened in reality, I want to tell you, the farmer friends, you are not united. You are not paid a good price. There's no storage facility for you. There's no food processing industry. So farmers have lost interest. And farming becoming very kind of challenging job. And farmer's son, seeing all film heroes, they don't want to put their leg on the slush. So here I'm giving the answer. How the farmer's son also can be brought. It's called collective farming. So the first idea I'm giving to all of you, form a Kisan Bhagawan. My friend, Mr. Ashok Kumar and his friends will all be co-founders. We are going to form Kisan Bhagawan. Kisan means farmer, Bhagawan means Kadavul, God. So what we will do, with all the towns, the farmers will unite. Suppose 300, 500 acres land will become one land. The cornerstone, they'll bury it. They need not worry. We'll have a bigger land. We'll have a bigger tractor. I'd been to South America, California University, where they plow the land with the tractors, which plow 6 feet. When the land is plowed 6 feet, the production is very high. We are using lesser capable tractors because the land, you know, the father dies, the four sons, the land becomes four pieces of land. It becomes four pieces of land and four wells, four pairs of bulls. Come on. And when they put the buns, four sons, you lose farmland. You can't cultivate in the buns. How many problems we are having? So I tell in Tamil, mana varappugalai edunga, nila varappugal mariyum. You remove the buns in the mind. The boundaries in the land will disappear. That's what my appeal to all the farmers. You make it a collective farm. Or buy in one place all of you together. And use heavy tractor, number one. Number two, tomato is sold 100 rupees per kilo or it is not sold. It's thrown. What you do, you set up a food processing industry. For all agriculture producers can set a small scale food processing industry. You can make from tomato soup, jam, pickles. And there's so many things you can make out of tomato. And all this you make it to the ISO standard, BIS standard, you can export it. So, third thing we are doing is through our friend, tomato is sold 0 rupee here, 1 rupee here, Chandigarh 100 rupees. Through internet we find where there is more market, better market. So, tomato packed well goes to Chandigarh. So, what I am trying to say, let us forget all these problems. First, let us make farming a beautiful profession. The same farmers' boys, we interviewed them. They said, we are feeling ashamed to take the plow. We said, will you drive a tractor? They said, why not? We'll drive tractors. So the son can be brought by tractors. How the tractors can? Now today, it's not displacing agricultural labor. We don't get people for agriculture. We don't get. So no farmers are coming. By mechanization means what I mean, what you need minimum mechanization, you do it. You use heavy tractors to plow the land. And food storage bins collectively they can construct, they can harvest, they can process the food, they can market it directly. Why intermediaries? We have a nice program, there's no intermediary. The farmers will create an idea, outlets, where the food will be packed and go directly to the retailer, not the intermediary. By that, the profit for farmers will increase. Kisan Bhagawan. I want to tell you farmers, never ever say no water. The Indian, any house you go, first thing they offer is water. Water, when you show water, you mean you're welcoming. But water has cells. You know, when Emoto, Masaru Emoto found, you put water, you put the water in the refrigerator, said thank you. You know, they formed into beautiful crystals. Stupid water, he said, he didn't form. You can, Masaru Emoto, you can go to Google and see. They form beautiful crystal. Millions of crystals, each crystal different from one another. Yes, made it. Waters are feeling. When you say no water, water listens. It may not also give you water. So water has feeling. You have a function. Suddenly, you know, you have prepared some food, drying it. Suddenly rain comes. You say, stupid rain, don't say that. And you will never get rain. I tell you, you will never get rain. Because rain has feeling. If you insult rain, you will not come. Insult water. If you say no water, your body cells are listening to you. You will not get water. There is water. What about the water falling into sea? Have you taken into account? Every rain, every flood is wasted. When, you know, people who deny water, they don't deny water when there's a flood. Only there's no water they deny. So water is important. Water is there. Water available to everyone, really. You will see the picture. Water available to you. It's not want of water. Want of water management. Kisan Bhagawan. Please add after the name Kisan, the word. Don't remove language. Kisan is a word because India, most of the people understand that. It's a Hindi word. Kisan, please add. After name, all of you, even if you grow one tree in your house, you are a kisan. Let us make everybody, you can grow vegetables, crops on a terrace. We grow groundnut on a terrace. You can grow that and then we put kisan. We'll make Indian population, whatever the 120 crores of kisans we'll create. Each one is a kisan. And the kisans, the village, they'll all be supported by us in the most challenging task. And I think I've spoken enough about Kisan Bhagawan, this our contact address is given. Those who want to join this movement, please join. If you planted even one tree, you are a kisan. Kisan is the most noblest profession. Kindly remember that. And already we are late. Already we are late. Already climate change is happening. Already you have enough greenhouse gases in the atmosphere. You can't reduce it. Now we are late. But we can definitely, we can't produce heaven. We can reduce the rigor of hell we suffer. And take the example of trade union, Kashmir, Kanyakumari, take the example of Rotary, Lions. They never get divided. But farmers are divided. Farmers have so many problems. If farmers don't divide themselves on waterfront, they can decide what the price they should get it. They'll get storage. So I request all the farmers, help each other. Help each other. It's not only people of different languages. Even in two villages, one village refusing water to another village, they should not do that. In the, you know, drinking water, water fountain in the streets, two women fight for water. I think water, we need to do sacrifice. Water is something very divine. Water is divine. Water is divine. And water, never ever say no water. I want to tell you. And Kisan Bhagawan. And water, we'll tell you, we have 100 ideas. We say it's not waste water, used water. We have a nice idea. How through bacteria, you can treat the entire sewage and send it back to your farmlands and grow your crops. So all the problems are compounding because we are not addressing the problem. We are creating new problems. We should stop this at once. And I request all the farmers, I prefer to touch your feet. Be united. And it's the same village, don't fight. There's one caste, the two castes. Both of them are already, you know, the other upper caste people have kept them low. And they are fighting between themselves. They are the same problems. Don't allow casteism to come. There's only one caste, farmers' caste. There's only one religion, farmers' religion. So farmers of India, farmers of the world, please unite. Farmers of India, unite. I appeal to you, Kisan Bhagawan, you are Bhagawan. Because you give us food. You give us food. So we should not, we apologize if you have not treated you well. We promised from today we will treat you well. And you know that if we treat you well, you will give us food. Thank you. Best wishes.